Hi everybody, good evening and welcome to our service tonight at Trinity Rainhill Online. We welcome you all, especially those of you if you're visiting us for the first time coming online. It's lovely to have you with us. We'd love to hear your comments and thoughts afterwards. You can comment on the YouTube channel if you're watching it there. But it's great to have you with us. Tonight we are just going to be singing together in a few moments, and later on we'll hear God's word being explained to us. And that's by our brother Sidney Elliott, who's pastor at Grace Church in Halewood, and it was great to have him with us again tonight to share the word with us, the last in his series on that wonderful Psalm 23. So we look forward to hearing from Sidney a bit later on. But we're going to start our evening tonight with a wonderful hymn of praise. Praise is rising, hearts are burning for you. We want to be with the Lord this evening, and it's a hymn that helps turn our face towards God as we begin our meeting tonight. So hopefully you'll enjoy singing it with me now.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Yeah. Hosanna, just our voices.
Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come and be way upon us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
Come and be your way.
Come and be way.
Well, that truly is a great hymn, isn't it? And the word that we sing a lot in that, Hosanna, is the word that means God save us, God help us. And that's what we need, isn't it, today, as we for many of us, we're struggling with this lockdown. And even though things are easing, it's still a very different world than what we thought we would be in 2020, isn't it? And so we do need the Lord to help us. But even if it wasn't for the pandemic, we'd still need God to help us, because life is often tough, isn't it? And even when it isn't, we need to know the way, and we need to know how we get on. And so we can shout every day with those people, Hosanna, Lord, help us, Lord, save us. And it's, so it's a great song, isn't it? But we come to him because he's the one worthy of our praise, as we've done that already this evening. I'm going to carry on by singing now another great hymn. It's a fairly new one for us. The title of it is Yet Not I, But Christ in Me. We know that we faced life, and we struggle with life, we struggle with some things, don't we? And when we meet challenges, what do? We can say with Paul the Apostle, I know that I can face them, but it's not I, it's Christ who lives in me. And we can overcome things, not I, but Christ who lives in me. So that's what the point of this hymn is all about. Let's sing it together now before we come a bit later and hear from our brother Sydney.
Gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to his. Oh, how strange and divine, I can seem all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. in me.
Okay, let's, having sung all those things, sung our praises, let's come before the Lord in prayer, shall we, and welcome him amongst us this evening. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to meet again tonight. We thank you for what we've been singing already, the worship we've been able to bring to you. And we thank you, Lord, that you are worthy of our praise. You are worthy of our thanksgiving. And it is to you that we turn and sing Hosanna. And shout Hosanna, because we do need you to help us. We are helpless without you. And Lord, we thank you that it is. We face life, not us, but you that lives in us. Those of us who know you have that wonderful assurance that you are with us everywhere we go. And so when we face challenges and we have to overcome them, we know it's not through ourselves, but through you. And we thank you for these wonderful gifts that we have from you. And as we're going to be thinking of in a moment, that this just is you being our shepherd, the wonderful good shepherd who looks after his sheep. And Lord, it's great to know that you are leading us by still waters, through the death's dark veil, and even through that, through death itself, to a table which is prepared for us. Lord, we thank you for the wonders of this brilliant psalm, and the wonders of your love for us, and the wonders of how you have dealt with us over these years. And Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you, Lord, that your love is unfailing. It doesn't change. And so, Lord, we pray that people tonight watching this, would all of us, Lord, would know something of that unfailing love in our hearts, particularly those who need a touch from you this evening. Father, we pray that as the word is shared, as we've sung together, that every one of us, Lord, would sense your presence with us through your Holy Spirit, drawing us closer to you, understanding that you are our shepherd who is calling us his sheep even tonight. Lord, we ask now that you bless our brother Sydney as he comes to bring your word to us. We pray you bless him and anoint him and equip him for the task ahead. We thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you that it's unchanging. We thank you that the word of the Lord will last forever. And so these are timeless things we're going to hear this evening, and we thank you for that. So prepare our hearts, Lord. Give us ears to hear and hearts to obey, we pray. And we ask this for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, now it's time to hand over to our brother Sydney. We do thank him once again for preaching for us this evening. So, Sydney, over to you.
Are you leaving a legacy? Sorry if that sounds pointed and personal. But I don't mean how much are you leaving to your kids and grandkids. Of course, there's a place for that. But are you leaving a spiritual legacy? David's legacy was remarkable. He left a system of government never known before in Israel, and that was key to the nation's survival. As well as that, prosperity throughout the land and the public worship of God was established. Also, a clear plan for the construction of the temple, together with a whole supply of materials to build it. But the most lasting legacy he gave them and us, the Psalms, his songs, his poems and prayers, the inspired inner beatings and breathings of his heart. The Psalms are mentioned or quoted almost 80 times in the New Testament. And get this, 11 times by Jesus. His most quoted Old Testament book. And in these difficult days, we're looking at the 23rd Psalm, known as the Shepherd's Psalm, or even better, the Sheep's Psalm. 3,000 years have come and gone since David composed this song, 30 centuries, during which time all of the material possessions he had are no more. I've been to the city of David, and the artifacts are limited. A glass case of coins and a couple of clay jars. And basically, that's that. The harp, that David played to soothe the jealous outbursts of Saul, gone. The well-worn book of the law that he read and meditated on night and day, gone. Great Goliath's huge sword, gone. His magnificent palace, and again I've stood in the ruins of his palace. All of the above, gone. Everything lies buried deep in the debris of the passing years. But this psalm, thousands of years old and yet as fresh today as the day it was first written. Psalm 23, probably the first words we memorized in Sunday school as children, and possibly the last words we want someone to whisper to us as we're dying. Who knows just how much this psalm has helped and comforted Christians down through the ages. This then is David's lasting legacy. Some say the 23rd Psalm is the greatest treasure of all the Psalms. It's certainly David's personal testimony, his God story, a clear statement of faith. The Lord is my shepherd. I have a day by day, moment by moment relationship with him. Don't forget Psalm 23 is messianic. In other words, it points to Jesus. It's all about him. He is the shepherd. Well, so far we've been to the pasture land and beside the still waters for rest and refreshment. As wandering, silly, stubborn sheep, we've felt the shepherd's correcting rod turning us round and turning us back. And slowly, but surely, we're learning to stay on the right path. We then descended into the valley and to the deep darkness. But even when everything's dark and dangerous, we're assured, absolutely assured, of his presence and his protection with us, defending us. And then last week, we headed for the hills, onto the tablelands, prepped and cleared so we could eat and drink all we want. And it's a picture of the bountiful provision offered to us in the gospel of Christ, a seat at the banqueting table. And we're invited. Come and welcome. Today, at long last, we're homeward bound, heading for the heavenly farmhouse. And let me again give you two words, two headings that sum up this final verse. Help and hope. My help and my hope. To begin with, my help. Having given us his God story, David now tells us what lies behind all of God's dealings with him. The motor, the engine, if you like, the driving force of the whole thing. David attributes everything to God's goodness and God's mercy. And please notice, it's an exclamation. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. He speaks with assurance and certainty and declares for all to hear this outburst of praise. God is good. The Bible says that God abounds in goodness. Elsewhere, David invites us to taste and see that God is good. Psalm 33, the earth is full of the goodness of God. So God's goodness. And then David speaks about God's mercy. How amazing is that? Mercy means giving us what we don't deserve. Psalm 103, he's full of mercy. Later in the Bible, we find he delights in mercy. He's rich in mercy. And it's because of his mercy that we're not consumed. So God's goodness and God's mercy. Often David unites the two. The Lord is good and his mercy is everlasting. Goodness to provide and mercy to pardon. And David needs both, as do we. No doubt his yesterdays and yesteryears are flooding into his mind. Days of youth, watching his flock, God preserved his life countless times from the paw of a bear and from the jaws and claws of a lion. In the valley of Elah, facing the overgrown Philistine giant, again, God delivered him. In the court of King Saul, once more God delivered him. In deserts and caves, under fire and under siege, but saved and spared by the goodness and mercy of God. Times of sadness and sorrow and sin, God's been good and God's been merciful. David ascribes everything to God and these double blessings, these twin blessings. And not only with hindsight, but with foresight, looking back and then looking forward in the rear view mirror as well as the front windscreen. A debtor to God's great goodness and the massive reservoir of God's mercy. All my life, from start to finish, and at every point in between, each day, his goodness and his mercy follows me. There used to be a television program called One Man and His Dog. Did you watch it? Someone told me recently it's still on. A competition for sheep farmers, for shepherds across the country. And at the slightest command, on the first whistle, the sheepdog rounds up the sheep and brings them back to the fold. From Glasgow, the only dogs I'd seen were crazy dogs chasing cars through the streets trying to bite the tyres. You think I'm joking? No, I'm not. But these sheepdogs were different. Outstanding sheepdogs who knew exactly what they were doing. Well, it was C.H. Spurgeon, the London pastor and prince of preachers, that's what he was called, of a bygone day who said, God's got two sheepdogs. Their names? One's called goodness and the other's called mercy. That's what David is telling us here. The Lord is my shepherd and he's dispatched his sheepdogs to follow me each and every step of the way. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. As I follow the shepherd, says David, his goodness and his mercy follow me, my help. And my hope, my heavenly hope. There's an old hymn we love to sing sometimes. Great is thy faithfulness. And one of the verses talks about strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Well, David's tomorrow is full of bright hope. He has eternal expectations, great expectations. I'm heading home, he says. God's two sheepdogs, goodness and mercy, will escort me safely all the way to the heavenly farmhouse. I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Obviously, David's writing about heaven from an Old Testament perspective. 1,000 years before Jesus came, and here we are 2,000 years later, we have the benefit of the whole sweep of what the Bible says about heaven. So let me give you a quick resume of what it says. Heaven is described, it's pictured as a kingdom with Jesus as king, everything under his supreme sovereignty. He rules and he reigns. Not only a kingdom, but a city. Hebrews 11 says, a city whose builder and maker is God. And according to Revelation, there's no need for the sun in that city. We'll live in the light of the unveiled glory of Jesus. He's the light of the celestial city. Listen, when Jesus claimed in the Gospels to be the light of the world, he wasn't using hyperbole. It was prophecy. And we find that the gates of that city are never shut. No lockdowns, no quarantine, no restrictions, no social distancing. And in the ancient world, when you went to a city, you were allowed in if your name was listed. Only then could you enter the city. The Bible tells us that to enter heaven's city, your name must be written in a book, in the Lamb's Book of Life. So here's the gospel. Our God, Jesus, came into human history. He lived and died and rose again to open up the gates of this city. And when I give my sin and myself to Jesus and ask for his forgiveness, my name goes into the guest list and he takes me to his city. With so much bad news, here's some good news to look forward to. I'm bound for that city. So a kingdom and a city. And then heaven is compared to a house or a home. Jesus called it the Father's house. It's the idea of family and friendship and fellowship and safety and security and warmth and welcome. What's more, heaven's like a garden. The Bible begins with a garden, the paradise of God. Garden means paradise. And the Bible ends with a garden. Remember, Jesus spoke to the dying thief about going to paradise. With me in paradise. Again, the book of Revelation describes God's gorgeous garden. Pure paradise, crystal-like rivers, the tree of life, fruit for all the nations. It's figurative language to whet our appetites. The Bible says so much about heaven, a kingdom, a city, a house, a garden, and a party, a celebration, a feast, a banquet with joy unspeakable, unimaginable joy and gladness. Once more, let me say, God's accommodating us. He's coming down to our level. He's speaking in ways that we understand so we might grasp something of its wonder. And do you see how it goes from this to this? Immensity to intimacy. A kingdom, then a city, a house, a family home, and a garden of beauty and splendor, and then a party, a garden party, where we celebrate unendingly. There we have a brief overview of the Bible's take on heaven. We did a whole series on heaven a number of years ago, and we might do so again soon. Let me just add one more thing. Bear in mind, please, that the Bible is a Hebrew book. You see, wasn't the Bible originally written in Hebrew and Greek and Aramaic? Absolutely, yes it was. but it was written in Hebrew style. We normally read Grecian books, Greek style writing. And here's the Greek style: beginning, middle, and end. That's the Greek way of writing books. But the Bible's different. It's Hebrew in format, Hebrew in style. And the Hebrew way of writing is this: beginning, middle, beginning. So beginning, Genesis 1 and 2. Middle, Genesis 3 all the way to Revelation 20. And then back to the beginning, Revelation 21 and 22. Back to what it was before. Before the fall, before sin, before the curse, before all the brokenness. And that day's coming. Jesus will return and there will be no more death. Pre-Genesis 3. Perfect. Yes, just now, believers die and go to be with Christ, the Bible says, which is far better. Absent from the body, present with the Lord. Paul said, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. The Christian's death day is their best day. Heaven, here we come. That's our hope in the face of death. But the Apostle Paul lifts his eyes from the grave to the sky. He has another hope, a blessed hope, the hope of the return of Jesus Christ. One day King Jesus will come again, and there will be a new heaven and a new earth wherein dwells righteousness. And we will be raised to newness of life. No more wars, no more tears. All these former things will pass away. Life and liberty, healing and unending health then. Please don't think chubby cherubs with flapping wings and fluffy clouds playing harps. How boring would that be? No. Everything we love and enjoy here, minus the negatives, without the effect of the fall, back to the beginning, but only better. No potential to fall ever again. Roaming the new realm, free to be all that God made us to be from the get-go. That's so important for us to understand. Now, with that said, back to Psalm 23. We have that fuller perspective, whereas David didn't. He was speaking, he was writing long before the New Testament. So his take is limited. And yet he still has amazing insight. He looks through the window, through the keyhole, as it were, and gets a tiny glimpse of what it might be like. And he says, I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Home for good. The forever farmhouse. In other words, all of God's flock, the shepherd's sheep, make it home. That's the point. Not if or might or maybe, but shall, will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Linking that to what Jesus said, I give to my sheep eternal life and they shall never perish. No one will be able to pluck them, snatch them, or wrench them from my hand. And of course, in the very same context, Jesus talks about laying down his life for the sheep and claiming to have power, authority to lay it down, and power and authority to take it up again. It's a reference to his death and his resurrection. Good Friday and Easter Sunday, dying for us and rising again for us. Remember what we said at the start. Psalm 23 is messianic. It's pointing to Jesus. He's the shepherd. And because of his death, and because of his resurrection, and only because of his death, and only because of his resurrection, can we make it home. We need to read this verse and join it to to Jesus. Through him, we become part of the kingdom. Through him, we enter the city. We make it home. We enjoy the party because he is the way, the only way to heaven. So by faith in the promised Saviour, David states, not with presumption, but with confidence, I shall dwell. The word dwell carries clear thoughts of permanency and residence. And so does the word forever, my heavenly home, my help and my hope. As we draw to a close, let me remind you of where we started our series. The Lord is my shepherd. The call of the gospel is for you to come to Jesus and begin a personal relationship with him, to know God for yourself. And there's only one way that that can happen. It's through Jesus Christ, his Son. And so I want to invite you right now, wherever you are, if you want to become a Christian, a follower of Jesus, if you want to belong to him and make him your shepherd, your saviour, your king, your Lord, your God, you can pray and say, Jesus, I want Psalm 23 to be true for me. How will you respond? David was often in isolation, in exile, in a dark place, in threatening and frightening situations, and he constantly cast himself on his shepherd's love and care. Lord, I'm coming to you and calling on you and committing myself to you. And more than ever, we should do the same. So many things mask the real state, the true condition that we're in. Now's the time to make it right between you and him and enjoy his peace, his presence, his protection, his provision, and the prospect of verse 6, a secure future, help and hope. That's where David brings us, from the pasture to the riverside, through the valley, up onto the tablelands, right to the farmhouse, from here to heaven. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. He takes me through the darkest valleys. He assures me and comforts me and stands guard over me. He prepares the table before me. He anoints my head with oil. He constantly pours water into my life until it's overflowing. And to crown it all, he sends his sheepdogs to follow me and escort me and bring me back home forever and for good. If you don't know Jesus as your shepherd, you can. If you do, then live in light of this today and tomorrow, this week, every week, until you're home and verse 6 becomes a reality. Let me finish by telling you a story, a true story. 21 years ago, my mum died. Caleb, who introduced the songs earlier, was just a little boy. At school, a few weeks later, he was asked by his teacher to write about his family. Here's what he wrote. I have two grannies and two granddads. I have a granny and a granddad who live in Northern Ireland. I have a granddad who lives in Scotland. And I have a granny who lives in heaven. Out of the mouth of a little child. Simple, straightforward, sorted and sure. Heaven, just as real as here. Absolutely. And for David, it was just as simple and straightforward and sorted and just as sure. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. God bless you.
Well, we do thank Sydney for bringing God's word to us this evening, and we thank you for, thank the Lord for all that it says to us this evening, that wonderful psalm. Surely goodness and mercy following us all the days of our life. What a wonderful promise for us this evening and everything that we've heard. So let's just bow our heads and give thanks to the Lord as we close our service this evening, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you again for being with us tonight. We thank you for your word to us. We thank you for our brother Sydney being willing to share that. Lord, we pray that through your Holy Spirit, you would make these words real to us, that we would really know you, our shepherd, and we would trust in you, and we would follow you wherever you lead us in the days to come. So help us to hear your word this evening, Lord. Holy Spirit, make it, apply it to our hearts, make it real to us. And we ask this for your glory, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's say the grace together, shall we? Wherever you are, just say it to those around you. If you're on your own, just say it to the screen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Well, the Lord bless you, keep you this week. We pray that you do have a good week. Don't forget to comment and send us any messages if you want to, either on the YouTube channel or on our Facebook page, or if you want to email me, you can do that as well. It'll be great to hear from you. But until then, tomorrow morning we will be meeting again at 8:30, as it were, for our thought for the day, continuing our look at Jonah the prophet from the Old Testament. So if you want to join me then, that would be great. The video, that video will be up online on our YouTube channel. All of the old videos are there, so you can choose to go and have a look at any of those anytime if you want to go back over anything again. And for those of you from Trinity Rainhill who are at the church watching us tonight, if you want to join us on Facebook Live in a few moments' time, 7:30, then I'll see you there. But until then, have a great evening. God bless. Bye-bye.